Hey everybody, it's Shu. So yesterday I put up a video that showed kind of an epic run back of a game that was not going my way. And I wanted to revisit it today because if you watch the video and, you know, it's sort of in a cheeky context, it's easy to come away with the idea of, oh, well, he just pulled, you know, the top deck answer that would save him. And without that, he'd probably be dead. And, you know, that's actually correct. But I wanted to draw attention to some of the details about how this game went, because I think it's a pretty good example of how we can learn from our games. Because it's absolutely true that had I not top-decked Refurbish at the time that I did, I would have lost. But there were numerous other opportunities where the opponent could have played things slightly differently and still come away with the win, or bare minimum, improved their chances quite a bit. So I wanted to go through this game and point out some of those mistakes so that we can get a better idea of, you know, the decisions that went into that game. I've put a watermark over their name because this isn't about making fun of them or anything. They made mistakes that, you know, some of them were not the best ideas. Some of them were completely sensible. But the point is to break it down and see why the game went the way it did. I find that it's often really useful to be able to look at your own games to spot your mistakes, but it's often difficult. The brain has trouble with self-criticism, so sometimes it can also be good to look at other people's games and spot their mistakes, and that makes it easier to spot the mistakes that you make yourself. So without further ado, we're going to get the show on the road, and we'll stop for a split screen every once in a while when we have other things to point out. So at this point right here, we mulled down to 5 at the start of the game, but we kept a hand that has several of the pieces necessary to get things going. We were able to chart a course to drop God Pharaoh's Gift into the grave. We have Champion of Wits, which next turn we'll be able to drop Angel of Invention into the grave. And at that point, all we need to do is find a refurbish to get this thing going. Our opponent went first, so they already have a strong advantage going first, going against somebody who has far fewer cards in their hand and somebody who has a combo that they need to put together extremely quickly against this fast, aggressive start. So opponents started with Voltaic Brawler, and I'm not sure if they are aware of the matchup yet or if this... they might have been aware of the matchup and that was why they chose to spend energy on this attack. Maybe thinking that they needed to get the damage moving as quickly as possible. But I don't think that spending the energy for Voltaic Brawler to do the one extra damage right now is worth the expenditure when there's more to be gained from having Voltaic Brawler have that energy when there is something that could otherwise block it. And if he does know this matchup, then he knows that Champion of Wits is a possibility. And by spending energy right now, he makes it possible for us later in the game to be able to have Champion of Wits profitably block Voltaic Brawler and have them trade, where if he had held off on spending the energy right now, he would have instead been able to pump Voltaic Brawler to be able to trample over Champion of Wits and survive. And that actually can make the difference in how the game goes later on. It's an extremely minor mistake, and I think, you know, it's easy to see why they might want to just get damage on the board as quickly as they can. But that one extra damage, like I said, I don't think it's worth giving up the benefits that Voltaic Brawler brings to creature versus creature combat by spending energy when there's a potential blocker on the board. So let's get back to the game. And this is where we see the downside of spending that energy on Voltaic Brawler earlier. If he had kept that energy, then he would be able to use it now for Voltaic Brawler to attack in a way where there would be no advantageous blocks. At this point, having no energy left, Champion of Wits can trade with Voltaic Brawler. Voltaic Brawler won't trample over, so the damage doesn't trample past, and we end up trading a guy that we are happy to have in the grave and take out one of his attackers and manage to just barely hang on. It is not the biggest mistake that's made in this game, which is about to come up, but it's a situation where had he held on to his resources and been a little more diligent about spending them at the right time, then his future mistakes wouldn't bury him quite as much as they do. And this is where the mistake really comes back to bite him. This is the big mistake that defines the game. And it's one that I focused on in sort of the jokey little video of this game that I did earlier. There's actually two problems here. One of them is much bigger than the other, but they sort of compound on each other. It doesn't help that he's also playing things in his first main that aren't going to help him here. Generally, you want to play things in your second main whenever it is advantageous, which is most of the time. If you don't get a benefit from playing something during the first main, then don't play it during the first main. Keep your options open because you don't know what your opponent is going to do, and you might need those resources. The problem here is not just that he's, you know, giving away information. It's that by tapping out, he no longer has the mana available for Rhonas the Indomitable to pump one of the attacking creatures. And that is a big deal because Rhonas the Indomitable, spend 3 mana, pump something 2-0. That is the difference between us living and dying. When this attack is done, we are going to have 2 life left. If he had spent that mana to pump something, we would be dead. There's nothing else we could do about it. Game over. But he spent it, and that means that we get to live another turn. But I want to focus also on the issue of using that mana to play Vivian Reed here, which I don't think does him any particular good. Now, this comes down to, again, does our opponent actually know the matchup? Do they know what our deck does? Because we have played plenty of cards that signal us as being on God Pharaoh's Gift. God Pharaoh's Gift is in the grave. We've played several looting cards that are pretty much only in God Pharaoh's Gift. I know Chart of Course shows up in Mono Blue Flyers, but it's clear that we're not playing that. And we have Minister of Inquiries, which I don't think gets played in anything other than God Pharaoh's Gift. So he should have an idea of what the deck is that we're playing. And maybe he just hasn't run into that deck. Maybe he doesn't know its signature cards. If that's the case, that ignorance costs him dearly. If he does know, then playing Vivian Reed is a big mistake here because this game is otherwise firmly in this player's control. Not only is he about to kill us, and even with giving us an extra turn here to recover, even with that, he should know that the only way we're going to claw this game back is if we get God Pharaoh's Gift active and we reanimate Angel of Invention and we start smashing home for big gains in lifelink to shore up against his attacks and be able to finish him off. Knowing that, you don't want to play Vivian Reed into a board where the only way the game continues moving on is if I play Angel of Invention. Because that means that Angel of Invention is going to come in and immediately kill Vivian Reed. You're going to get the plus activation, and that's the end of it. That's all you get out of your Planeswalker. That's a really sorry deal. But more to the point, Vivian Reed has an option to shoot down flying creatures. Again, he should know the only way we win this game is if we reanimate Angel of Invention, a flying creature, with God Pharaoh's Gift. To that end, he should hold on to Vivian Reed, because if we play Angel of Invention, he can just plop down Vivian Reed in response and shoot down our angel. Instead, the one card he has that can interact with our way to claw this game back has been put out there to be vulnerable. And when it becomes our turn, and when we refurbish God Pharaoh's gift onto the battlefield, and we get Angel of Invention is going to do what it needs to do to stay on this board, and it's going to immediately kill Vivian Reed. So at this point, he spent the mana that could have killed us, giving us an extra turn, big mistake, and he spent it to make his one out against our one out vulnerable, also big mistake. But he could still claw this game back. There are still some mistakes to be made, so let's get on to those. Okay, so we saw the outcomes of the previous mistakes. We were able to trade out Champion of Wits to take out his Voltaic Brawler, resulting in a weaker board here. Vivian Reed was played out too early, which allowed us to take it out using Angel of Invention rather than vice versa. And now we go to him trying to put this game away, and the mistake that he makes here is that he's attacking with Llanowar Elves in addition to the larger opponents. So why is that a problem? The problem with it is the only way he's going to beat me is going to be to do damage while also getting rid of this angel. If he attacks with Llanowar Elves, we are able to just block that instead of the more threatening creatures, which gives us, when we go to damage, the lifelink from the angel will put us at 14, and then the two that are hitting us for 5 will drop us back down to 4. So even though the angel is blocking something that isn't an actual threat, it's allowing us to basically shore up our life total for free rather than forcing us to engage the angel with something dangerous. If he had attacked with only Steelleaf Champion and Rhonas, then we need to block one of them, because at 8 life we can't afford to take 10 damage. But if we block Rhonas, the angel dies because of Death Touch. Rhonas survives because it's indestructible. And suddenly we're back to having to top deck, and the game looks much stronger for the opponent. If we block Steel Leaf Champion, which becomes our best block if he doesn't attack with Llanowar Elves, Rhonas can pump it so that it can do enough damage to trade with our angel. Rhonas is no longer able to attack at this point, but there are plenty of big threats coming our way, and in fact we know that he has a dinosaur that can activate Rhonas next turn. So if he attacks with the two larger creatures, we have to block one of them, we have to lose the angel, and that puts us back into the mode of scrambling to get another one going so that we can keep shoring up our life total and we can keep presenting threats that can fight through his board. If we don't have an angel, we're left trying to fight back with ground threats, which are going to be outclassed by our opponent and be unable to fight through and bring him down. Attacking with Llanowar Elves allowed us to shore up our life total, and it allowed us to keep our angel at the same time. There is a play option that I considered when I made this block, and there's a reason you see hesitation when I make the block. And it would have been incredibly impressive if he did it. I don't know what the other cards are in his hand, so I don't know if it was an option. I suspect it wasn't, because his deck seems incredibly creature-focused, but it would have been supremely clever to attack with these and give me that option to try to shore up my life total against Llanowar Elves and not have to engage the things that threaten my angel. And then before damage assignment, cast a burn spell at his own elves. What would that do? That would mean that when we go to damage assignment, The angel would have nothing to hit. I wouldn't gain that life. I'd be stuck at 8 life. And then I take the 10 damage from the other two creatures and the game is over. That would have been slick as hell, and I wouldn't even be mad. But for one reason or another, maybe he didn't have the cards, maybe he didn't realize that it was an opening, he didn't manage to do that, and we are able to claw back our life total. But there's still opportunities to roll away with this game. There's still one more chance, and he doesn't make use of it, so let's go and find that spot. Did you see what happened? Or rather, what didn't happen? He went through his turn, and he didn't make use of his attack phase. Now, I understand the hesitation to make use of it. The last time he tried to make use of his attack phase against me, it didn't go well. I shored up my life total, I killed an elf, and while I was briefly brought closer to being dead, the attack phase that I had the following turn put me back into a spot where I, once again, am difficult to kill. So I understand his hesitation to attack. However, there were a couple options here where he would still have a reasonable chance at winning this game. And he needs to take those chances because he's seen what the deck does. And he knows that I've placed another Angel of Invention in the grave. It's on top of the grave right now. And he's seen what God Pharaoh's Gift does. So he should know that next turn, God Pharaoh's Gift is going to reanimate another Angel of Invention. The two of them are going to buff each other with their Anthem effects, so they're each going to be 7-7, and that's enough to end the game. So he needs to get rid of this Angel right now. There's a few ways to go about it. The smarter one is the one where you don't play your things on your first main phase and you still have mana available, and you swing with Ronus, you swing with Steel Leaf Champion, and you swing with Regisaur Alpha, and you force me to block one of them. And you use Ronus to pump and have something trade with the Angel. I'm going to gain some life again, but the Angel's going to be gone. And that's going to slow the pace that I can take this guy out. And it's going to give him more turns to draw into something that could take out God Pharaoh's Gift or find a way to get through my reanimating army of dudes and finish the game off. That's the smartest play available. Attack with your big guys, use Ronus to pump, and get something to trade with this angel and make the game go longer, rather than sit there and wait for me to kill you the following turn. But let's assume that he didn't figure that out right away. Let's assume that he played something first main and used up all his mana, and so it's now no longer an option to have Ronus pump something. Still, there's a chance, there's a Hail Mary chance that he could take. He should play this out and hope that it's enough to put the game, it won't put the game away. Hope that it's enough to take this angel out of commission so that I don't kill him next turn, and let the game progress further and see if he can draw one of his outs. And that option is to attack with Ronus solo. Now, I'm smart enough to know that I'm not going to block Ronus with Angel of Invention, because I know that Ronus has Death Touch, and I know that Ronus is indestructible. I don't want to lose Angel of Invention to that. But sometimes people make mistakes. Sometimes they make mistakes. Sometimes it just becomes a habit to play by reflex. Sometimes people get cocky. There's all sorts of reasons that I could make the mistake. He should give me the opportunity to make that mistake. If he's already spent all his mana and he doesn't have the best available play, at least swing with Ronas and give me the chance to get my angel killed. Because if you don't give me that chance, I am guaranteed to win next turn when I play the next angel and attack. Any plan that relies on me being too stupid to swing with my guys when the win is there is a bad plan. At least give me the opportunity to make a mistake and swing with Ronas solo. But unfortunately for him, our opponent doesn't do that, and he passes the entire turn without using any of his combat phase, and that's when the inevitable happens, and we resurrect another Angel of Invention, and we put the game away. Anyway, I hope that this was helpful to people. If it's something you'd like to see more of, please let me know in the comments. I like doing these kinds of videos. I don't know if other people enjoy them as much as me. I think they're pretty fun to do. I think it's really interesting to break down the different angles of play and try to understand how the game works. If it's helpful, again, let me know. If you didn't like it, let me know. I find it was helpful for me. I like being able to understand these kind of mistakes, understand where my outs were. And when you break down a game like this, it really helps to regulate your own salt levels. Like, salt is a normal human response. It's something that makes complete sense. Magic is a game that involves a lot of reasoning, a lot of decision making, a lot of intelligence. So when we lose a game, we start getting defensive. We start to look for a reason that we lost that doesn't implicate our intelligence. And that makes it really hard to give fair evaluations of the decisions that we made. And that's understandable. Like, it's a character flaw, but it doesn't make you a bad person. It's just an ordinary thing that people do. So it really helps to look at these kinds of games after the fact and break them down dispassionately. And it's easier to break down a game dispassionately and spot mistakes when they're not your own. I'm not saying don't criticize your own games. Absolutely do criticize your own games. Learn to find your flaws. But looking at a game like this and looking at the mistakes other people make can help you get in the mindset where you're better able to understand the mistakes you make later and you can avoid making them in the future. Anyway, I had a lot of fun with this. I hope you did too. And I will see you in the arena.